Hi, I'm Dr. Carrie Lam, and welcome to the Dr. Lam Show, where we try to talk about integrative or preventive medicine, but also just trying to change the future of medicine. I have Eric Edmeades here today with me, the founder of WildFit, as he's helped over 50,000 people in 130 countries change their relationship with food. We know that food is just so important to health, so I welcome you, Eric, to our podcast show today.
Oh, thanks for having me.
So tell me about your journey and how you got to where you're doing what you love to do.
Yeah, I like a lot of things, I was just solving a problem for myself. You know, I had spent a lot of years sick and, you know, on various medications and visiting doctors and specialists for a variety of ailments and never really getting anywhere. And then, you know, some friends kind of inspired me to think about food a little bit more. And I decided to undertake kind of a challenge and, you know, just change things a little bit. And 30 days later, I'd lost 35 pounds and I, you know, basically every ailment that I had was gone. And mm-hmm. I became really curious about that stuff. And, and then kind of separately, I went off and got involved in business and I was doing my thing, but under the surface of it all the time was this fascination with health and why it was like, you know, friends of mine would see that I lost all this weight and all this other stuff. And they would ask me how I did it. And I would tell them, I go, eat more of this, eat less of that, do a little of this, do a little of that. And then they wouldn't do it. You know, it's like, and I was really surprised at that. And then of course I got talking to a lot of doctors that were saying the same thing. They're like talking to their clients saying, you know, if you keep carrying on like this, it's going to be, you know, pre-diabetes and then it's going to be diabetic. And, you know, and, but if you do this and this, but then they wouldn't do it. No. And that's when I really decided to get into, some really pioneering work around what drives eating behaviors, eating decisions and so forth. And that's what kind of gave birth to creating WildFit. Is like, I knew that I had some really solid nutritional principles to teach, but I also knew that people fundamentally aren't good at following quote diets. And I had to figure out a better way to do that.
You're so right. It's very hard for people to change and to create new habits, right? So can you kind of define the terms like food psychology, self-care, evolutionary biology? Those are big words.
Sure. So for me, self-care, I'll start there. Self-care is the ultimate healthcare. It means that you prioritize your physical existence, that you floss your teeth, that you eat the right food, that you move your body, that you recognize that this is the only vehicle you get and you can't trade it in, at least not until Elon Musk figures out how to help us do all that. But, you know, like
in Mars.
Yeah, exactly. You know, but self-care is the idea that, you know, I think right now we have an idea in medicine that you just basically live your life. And then when you get sick, you go to a doctor to try to fix that for you. And mm-hmm. self-care basically says, I'm going to do everything I can to never have to go see my doctor. Sorry, because I know you're a doctor.
That's great. I love that. Prevent and, it.
So that's self-care. Food psychology, really what that means to me is understanding the driving force behind people's non-functional eating decisions. So, you know, we all know that we have to eat and we have to eat food. We kind of get that, right? But the majority of people are not making their food decisions, at least not the majority of their decisions, based on the nutritional needs of the body. They're basically choosing various forms of pleasure, what tastes good for them, what their cravings are answering for them. They're eating largely for, say, memory purposes, nostalgia, or emotional reasons. And so when you get into understanding how those things came up for people, when you really begin to understand the psychology of why somebody feels like they have to have a pizza when they've had a bad day, when you can unlock those things, you can move them toward a level of consciousness that allows them to make really good conscious food decisions without having to rely on a bunch of willpower. Because willpower is not designed for, like, I'm going to live a certain way for a very long time. That's not what willpower is for.
Right, right. You can't change by always just using your will, right? It has to become second nature. You have to. So what does it mean to, like, you know, unlock someone's psychology? You're saying that there's a reason for why they're eating this type of food, whether it's like it's easy to get or they're addicted to it, or are there some like neural pathways that rewards them, all right, when they eat that food?
Yeah, there are so many examples. You know, simple thing, child falls down, skins their knee, crying, parents wanting to do everything they can to distract them from the pain, goes over, gives them a hug and a kiss and a cookie. And the kid, you know, links those, all those things up, and the cookie now means love, and the cookie also means pain relief. And because it did, it distracted from the pain. And so children make those linkages when they're very young. And then we wonder why we're kind of stuck with those things later. And then of course there's many other things, like, various food industries have like acquired emotional states or acquired our holidays. You know, there are Christian people today that can't really fully enjoy Easter if they don't have chocolate. You know, like they just, and it's like, well, that's the tradition. No, I've read that book. And I don't recall chocolate being mentioned anywhere in that story, but somebody came along and sponsored the holiday. And now, so there's understanding that type of thing. And then I'll give you a really personal example from a friend of mine. Yeah, she had done our core 90-day program that's around reframing the psychology and establishing a new lifestyle. And she did very well on it. And then I saw her in another class. And, you know, a lot of times our clients will come and do it again, or, you know, to do it like a deeper level or a recap or whatever. And I asked her, what drove you to come back? And she goes, you know, I'm on track in every way. And by the way, she had written to me grateful that for the first time since she was a teenager, she was happy to go to the beach in a two-piece swimsuit. Like, you know, it was life-changing what she'd been through. But I said, what brought you back? And she goes, well, I just have this craving for icing all the time, like icing, like out of the can icing. Like I just want icing all the time. And I go, oh, really? And she goes, yeah. And I said, I'm like, well, you know, tell me about your history of icing. Like, you know, what were your earliest experiences? And she said, oh, well, you know, my mom used to bake at home. And immediately I jumped conclusion. Like, I'm immediately like, oh, I know what it is. Your mom made homemade icing, and then she let you lick out the bowl and blah, blah, blah. And she goes, No, my mom used pre-made icing in the can. I'm like, okay, tell me the rest. She goes, well, I'd hear the can opener. I'd run down the stairs. I'd sneak under the counter. I'd reach up and feel for a spoon. And then I'd find the can and I'd scoop out one spoon. I'd take it. And she'd usually let me get like the second one. And then she'd catch me and I'd be in fake trouble, and we'd laugh and we'd hug, and then we'd bake together. And I said, I see. I said, how's your relationship with your mother right now? And she says, with tears brimming in her eyes, she says, she's in early stage dementia. She's slipping away. And then her eyes go wide and she sees something that she couldn't see on her own. And that is that the craving for icing is coming up right now as her connection with her mother is going down. And so she's eating the icing to try to reclaim the connection that she established with her mom as a child. And she had no idea of that, no idea. But by shining a light on it, it allowed her to address it and you know, create a conscious relationship with it and understand it and realize it was never going to work anyway. That's not going, you know, it's not actually going to work. So you may as well stop.
Yeah. That really has a big light bulb when you can figure out what.
Yeah. And then there's, you mentioned the neuropathways. There's also the biochemistry behind psychology. And, you know, as an example, some children are playing hockey and they lose the game and they're all depressed in the car. And so the coach is like, God, these poor kids, they worked so hard. And he goes, you know what, guys, let's go get some pizza and Cokes and ice cream. And they're like, yay. And what he doesn't realize is that what he's doing is showing them that when they, first of all, that losing is the path to tremendous caloric reward, artificial fats and sugars and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And that emotionally you can distract from your pain of losing by just eating junk. And what the coach doesn't know all that. The coach is just doing the best he can or she can in that moment. Right. But the kids are going to be left with that anchor, that trigger. And here's part of what will happen is that the minute the coach says to them, we're going to get pizza and Cokes and ice cream or whatever. The minute the coach says that, the children already start producing serotonin and dopamine before they've even eaten the food. And now the problem is that they drive into the establishment, they're stoned. They're basically, it's like they've taken ecstasy. They may as well have taken ecstasy. They're stoned. They walk in there. The logo looks amazing. The smell is fulfilling. And the taste is better than it really is because they're full of feel-good drugs. And now they link this feel-good drug experience to that particular food. And they wonder why at 45 years old, when they had a bad day, they want to order a pizza.
That's true. Or when you have a breakup, you go for the ice cream or something.
Exactly.
Like that, right.
Mm-hmm. You know, because ice cream is the path to connection, obviously.
Yeah. And I mean, sugar has a lot to deal with it too, right? Not only how does sugar affect that pathway?
Well, you know, first, there's something fascinating about language. And, you know, I think that language gets lazy sometimes. So, you know, let's start with this question. Is sugar good or bad? Yes. Sugar can be good or bad. Is fat good or bad? Yes. And, you know, we use the word fat and inside that one word fat, there's trans fats, there's polyunsaturated fats, there's saturated fats, and there's a million different fats, some of which we are essential to our existence and some of which are massively detrimental. Well, I would say the same is true with sugar. I mean, I'd argue against any sugars being essential, but what I would say is that our ancestors, sugar was essential for them. And it was largely essential for them because sugar was predominantly delivered in the way of fruit and honey and arguably some root vegetables that were kind of high, you know, starchy content, but most of which are what we would consider fall season foods. And the reason that we really needed those things at that point is they were the indicator that winter was coming, that the drought was going to begin. And so when you're eating those foods, your body gets this, oh, winter's coming. And then of course the whole insulin system is firing and you're taking in the sugars and you're putting some in the blood for immediate energy. And then when the blood sugar's full, then you're storing the glycogen. And then when your glycogen is full, then you start storing fat. And that's great because winter's coming and you better have some fat.
Yeah.
So for our ancestors, stumbling upon a tree of ripening fruit was like, hallelujah, angels singing in the breeze, man. Like,
or honey, you know, right?
Yeah. Or honey. Oh my God, honey. And so the trouble is that today our system still rewards us for that. Only the vast majority of the sugar we eat is toxic rubbish. And even the good stuff, we have way too ready access to it. And so we eat it too often because there's no instinct in us to go, oh, I've had enough sugar. There's not. I mean, yeah, you can overdo it, but truthfully, people will, when they finally reach the point of overdoing it, they've gone way past overdoing it.
Yeah, they're crashed. They go running around the block and then they crash right after, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's good to know about the food psychology and self-care. And what exactly is evolutionary biology and how does it, you know, affect how we look at food and
our evolutionary biology it obviously is a science, and it's a science of in as applies to humans. It's a science to the history of our evolution as a species, and I believe that it's important to look at evolutionary biology because, frankly, any present day science, research, statistics, fads, concepts, anything that violates the principles of evolutionary biology must be considered suspect and must be looked at more than once. And what I mean by that is that, like, here's a great example. If somebody were to come along and try to convince us that dairy products were essential, like essential, never mind good or bad, just if they try to say they were essential, we would then be able to look at our history as a species. And we would see that in our history, dairy products happened a blink of an eye ago. And so our 99.99% of our ancestors survived just fine without dairy products. So therefore it's unlikely that they're essential. Now we can get into further debates about whether they're good or not, or whether they're bad or not, but we can definitely draw a line under the essential thing and go, this seems very unlikely. You know, I would argue the same thing with avocados. You know, people are, oh, you've got to get your avocados, the folic acid and the good healthy fats. Yeah, I agree there's good things in there, but as avocados originate in South America, and you know, South America is one of the most recently populated places, particularly from a developed world perspective. You know, the first time your DNA ate anything from South America might have been 300 years ago,
yeah,
earliest.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so again, blink of an eye in evolutionary biology. And so therefore, we would draw a line under and say, look, I'm not arguing the good or bad right now. We're just saying can't be essential.
So what would you say is an essential diet based on our evolution? Is it culture dependent, or we're doing?
No, like, I don't believe that it is culture dependent.
There's just one, because we're all human.
I believe that every single human on earth has the same essential nutritional requirements. You and I come from very different evolutionary backgrounds, but only splitting very recently. Yes. And so, you know, one might come along and say, well, you should be eating this and this and this from your part of the world, and I should be eating this and this. But here's the truth. We both need vitamin D. We both need vitamin K. We both need vitamin C. We both need saturated fats. We both need a variety of healthy fats. We both need all the amino acids. Like your and my dietary requirements are the same. They are the same. The only difference that might exist a little bit between us has to do with our activity and our genders. That, you know, I suspect that there are some differences because, of course, you know, you guys are built for manufacturing human beings, and you know, and we men don't have to do the manufacturing part. And so there are some different metabolistic reasons. But at the end of the day, I believe that we all effectively have the same nutritional requirements. And the degree to which we meet those correctly is the degree to which we experience optimal health.
Mm. So different types of foods provide different amino acids, right? Essential, non-essential, and vitamins, because our bodies can't make vitamin C. So would we have to get it mostly just through different foods that we're eating?
I would suggest that the way we would look at this is to say that the longer a food has been in consumption, the more likely it is that it is both, digestible, that it might be good for us, and even more than it might even have become essential. This is a kind of a complicated idea that I think about speaking of evolution or biology, but imagine that it's 100,000 years ago and you and I are starving, it's a drought, and none of our normal foods are around. So what's going to happen is at some point in time, we're going to get hungry enough that we're going to start getting flexible about what we eat, right? Like we're going to be like, you know, I don't know. We don't normally eat that bush over there, but I'm hungry enough to give it a go. Have you ever eaten it? Do you know anybody who's eaten it? Did anybody get sick? There's going to come a point where we're going to want to eat that thing. And the minute we're eating something that is not known to be edible, the first thing we have to know is, can we bypass the defenses of that plant? That plant's going to try to defend itself initially with thorns and that sort of stuff, but it might also defend itself biochemically. And so are we ready for that? So that's hurdle number one. Then hurdle number two is, do we have the capacity to extract any of the nutrients that are in there? Look, the nutrients are there, but that doesn't mean we can have them. My desk is made out of wood. It's probably full of all kinds of interesting nutrients that termites and beavers can have, but they're not available to me, even if I take it and put it in a blender, right? Like, so that's mm-hmm. the second hurdle is, can we even extract? Is it bioavailable to us? And then the third hurdle is, have we potentially stopped producing a particular nutrient for ourselves that we're now getting from this food? And oh my gosh, now that food has become staple. Mm-hmm. So the timeframes for all those things to happen are phenomenally long. And so that's why to me, it seems like the longer we've been consuming any particular food product, the better it is that we're overcoming the defenses, the more likely it is that we're able to extract good nutrition from it. And of course, the more likely it is that it might even be an essential thing because we've been eating it for so long.
So can you give some examples? Like what would a breakfast, a lunch, a dinner look like of someone back in the day that would be coming here to our grocery store or something like that?
So this is a very normal question people want to ask. Like, what's a normal meal? Okay. There's a very important principle for us to understand, and that is that our ancestors evolved to, they involved an environment that had seasonal fluctuation. And what that meant is that the environment changed dramatically, and they didn't have houses and technology and what have you. So they had to figure out how to survive these changes. Mm-hmm. And so not only did our ancestors go through that, but they evolved the ability not, you know, both to survive those seasonal fluctuations, but then also to utilize them. So each of the seasons puts our bodies in, let's say, a different mode, and that mode is actually important to our health. So, you know, for example, winter would have been the toughest time, a drought and a lack of food, a lack of plant food, a lack of hunting, everything would have been difficult. So that seems like a tough season to survive. Well, luckily in fall, we ate a lot of carbohydrates. We fattened up, we stored some hydration, we stored some energy. And so we're going to make it through the winter. But what if the winter gets really long? I don't know. We'll see what happens. So then the body goes, all right, we've evolved the ability to pack on the extra fat to prepare for this. But now that we're in winter, what can we do with this? And so in this case, we have a function called autophagy, as you know, and in autophagy, the body starts saying, all right, we don't have any sugar. to burn
down fat,
and we're kind of like, we don't want to burn all our fat. You know what? We're going to burn some of the protein that we have. Right. And of course, fitness trainers are famous for walking around. Don't burn your protein. That's bad. You know, you worked hard to get those muscles. You don't want to. Yeah. Except that the body, the way I like to think of it is that, again, imagine you and me, we're trapped in a big manor in the north of Europe, and it's minus 40 outside, and then the furnace stops, and then we run out of firewood. What are we going to do? Well, we're going to start burning furniture, but we're not going to go grab granny's grand piano first, right? We're going to go grab the broken picnic table, and then that one frame that broke that no pictures in. We're going to bring all the broken stuff and burn that first. And the body does that. So in winter, the body goes through this, like, I'm going to burn the old proteins first, which is incredibly cleansing and important. The sad reality is most of us live in the developed world. We never experience that winter because there's such an abundance of food around. So when you ask, like, what's a typical meal, for example, the answer is there isn't one. There may be typical meals depending on the season you're in. So, for example, when I'm in what we would call spring, which is a season of abundance, fresh plants growing, good hunting if you're not a vegetarian, then when we're in that season, then predominantly my meals will be made up of those things, green leafy vegetables and low starch vegetables and you know, meat, fish, and eggs and that kind of stuff. Whereas if I move into summer, then I may have, some summer berries and maybe a little bit of root vegetables, a few more carbs come into my life. When I go into fall, I'm eating carbs, like I'm eating lots of, you know, sweet potatoes and lots more honey and eating a lot more carbs. And then, of course, when I go into winter, then I would practice some form of fasting from time to time. So there's not really one particular like meal. There's more recognizing that there's these metabolistic modes that we need to get into, and seasons control that.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So you practice this, this way of eating.
Yep.
Yeah. And so the evolution way of eating is basically just seeing how your ancestors would have eaten based on the seasons and trying to emulate that, rather than having abundance of food all the time, like in our days, right? So that's great. That's great to learn about. What else would you like to talk to us about your people with their relationship with food?
Well, I think that one of the key things to consider is that here's what doesn't work. What doesn't work is telling people, here are a bunch of rules, and now follow them and give up all the stuff you love and give up all your memories and give up all your habits. And you have to change all that now. And, you know, and if you do this, everything's it just doesn't work. The diet industry doesn't work. It doesn't work for a lot of reasons. One is that when you give somebody rules, it inspires their inner rebel, which is crazy because now you said don't eat chocolate. And then when they go eat chocolate, they get an extra serotonin and dopamine rush because they broke the rules. So they actually get rewarded chemically for breaking the rules. Diets are flawed in a million ways. Another way that diets are flawed is that the average person living in what we might refer to as the developed world is overfed energy and stimulants and underfed non-energy nutrition. So they're quite literally starving to death while being overstimulated, which is one of the reasons we see the kind of aggression that we do. And this, you know, it's a challenging place to be. So the trouble, though, is that now you take one of those people and say, well, you're going to go on a diet, which usually involves some kind of food restriction or calorie restriction. But hold on a minute, they were already nutritionally starving, which is why they were overeating in the first place, even though that what they were eating wasn't solving the nutritional problem. That's what was going on. Now we take them and put them on a calorie restriction diet, and their body goes from, I think I'm starving, to holy shit, I really know that I'm starving. And then they will relapse and eat the entire fridge.
Yeah.
And, you know, so the diet industry just, you know, doesn't work that way. Mm-hmm. I think what we really have to do is, as we talked about earlier, we have to look at the psychology. We have to look at why it is that we choose to eat the things we do, what triggers that. When I'm feeling lonely, what is the food that lonely answers? Is it chocolate? Because let's be honest, does it really? Not if you're not sharing it with somebody. Like, you know, so I think that understanding that the personal psychology around food is how we make a change. Because going back to willpower, here's my favorite way to describe willpower for people so they really get it. Because a lot of people are like, willpower just doesn't work. Yeah, it does. It does work. You need to understand what it is, though. And here's what willpower is not. Somebody who is an alcoholic who wants to quit drinking is not going to use willpower to stop drinking. They might use willpower to not drink for an hour or even a day or even a week, But at some point in time, that willpower is going to release. It's something that you cannot hold. And the best metaphor I have for it is that willpower is what you use to hold your breath. So if you want to dive under the water, you can use willpower to hold your breath. But there's going to come a moment where your body is going to mutiny against the willpower and force you to take an inward breath, even if you are underwater. Mm-hmm. That's how willpower works. And I think that's why when, you know, a lot of times when people look at, like, you know, when they see somebody that's really healthy, or many times our clients, their friends go, oh my God, you got to tell me, you know, what you're eating. And they're like, it doesn't work to do that. It doesn't work to go eat this, don't eat that, eat this, don't eat that, because they haven't solved the core why. They haven't understood why they're eating that thing. And then effectively they haven't created freedom for themselves, because we really want them to have a sense that they can eat whatever they want and feel good about it, but that they can also not eat what they wish they wouldn't eat and feel good about it.
So yeah, I deal with a lot of patients that have eliminated a lot of foods, right? And it part of it is very sad, because they eliminated, because yes, functional medicine tries to get down to say, hey, this food is bad, this food is not bad, because the GMOs or things like that. But I think finding the why is definitely way more important than just giving a list of, you know, yeses, nos, and like you said, the willpower, because that will ultimately, you can't just stop restricting your whole life, because then you're missing out on good nutrients too, right? So that's a very good point.
I was having a very interesting conversation with one of the founders of Zumba and the fitness brand. And he was working on a branding workshop with me. And he asked, he asked me what was the feeling that he felt I was delivering to my clients and what my coaches were delivering to their clients around the world. And I said, well, I would have to say it's freedom. And he's like, well, you know, freedom is a very big word. Like, really, freedom? Do you think that's really the word? And I'm like, well, I can't find a better one right now. And we wrapped up the workshop. And then the next morning we were having breakfast and we were in this luxury hotel in Jamaica. And a guy walked out the buffet and he recognized me. And you know, funny thing, when people recognize you, they have to remind you who you are. Like, oh my God, you're Dr. Lam. Oh my God. Whatever. So this guy comes in and goes, oh my God, you're Eric Edmeades. Yes, I am. Thank you for the reminder. And he says, listen, I just want to thank you. And I said, great, what for? And he says, for my freedom. And I was like, I thought Jeffrey put him up to it, man. But he didn't. And Jeffrey immediately turned to him and said, what do you mean by freedom? And he put it like this. He goes, I just walked out the buffet. I got all this food on my plate. It's all good, healthy food. And I just realized it's the first time I've been through a buffet like that and didn't see the cookies, croissants and donuts and muffins and shit. Like, I just didn't see it. And it's like, so I walked in and took another look and it was all there. It's just, I didn't see it before because I don't care about it anymore. That's what we call the zero point. Willpower is the flapping of your wings, and you do have to flap your wings to get liftoff. But if you do it the right way, you can eventually get to the place where you're like, oh, I don't need to flap my wings anymore. I've passed the zero point. I am free.
That's awesome. Well, thanks, Eric. Thanks, Eric. You're at Eric Edmeades. So if people wanted to get a hold of you, where can they find you?
You know, I manage my own Instagram account. They can certainly come and find me there. Anybody's got follow-up questions, I do my best to answer the DMs when people send them to me. Anybody who wants to examine food freedom and really the relationship with food should go to getwildfit.com, where we have a 14-day reset program they can try right there.
And then your socials is at Eric Meade.
At Eric Edmeades.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'm very grateful to have you on the Dr. Lam Show. I hope everyone who's watched this has really enjoyed what we've talked about today. If you've liked it, make sure you subscribe and share, and we'll see you at the next episode.